Okay, well, first of all, thank you so much for having me here. And I also have to excuse for my lack of Spanish. So I'll do my presentation in English. My presentation will be in two parts. The first part will be on how we work on mitigation on our climate action plan in Copenhagen. And the second part will be on how we are working with climate change adaptation, adjusting the city to a changing climate. Sorry. The reason why, of course, we started working on this is obvious. I mean, we can see that global temperatures are rising. We can also see that cities play a greater role in the world and also when it comes to emissions. And you might ask yourself, well, what can Copenhagen do about that? We're a very, very tiny city, 600,000 people living in the city itself, 2 million people in the greater Copenhagen region. So, I mean, I'm not sure that you will actually be able to measure the fact that we are working to become carbon neutral in Copenhagen. But we are doing it also to demonstrate that it's actually possible to do that as a developed city and hopefully also setting an example for other cities to follow us. A few words about sort of what we are, the approach also in Copenhagen. Copenhagen has a reputation of being a livable city, and that's also part of our vision about co-creating Copenhagen. Bicycling, good everyday life, and having more green in the city is some of the issues that we are working with. We are also responsible, and we want to be responsible both here and now, but especially also for future generations. That's why we have set up the goal of becoming carbon neutral in 2025. We are working on climate change adaptation, and we are also looking for a responsible use of resources in the city. And finally, we want to be a city where there's still room for differences, for flexibility and creativity. Some of people coming to Copenhagen might find it us a little bit boring because everything is so well regulated and so on. And we want to make sure that there's still room for a little bit of freakiness here and there in the corners. When it comes to the climate plan, we have sort of the climate plan was developed in 2009, and it was the first plan. It was actually developed for the COP15 meeting in Copenhagen. That didn't go that well, I'm sorry to say. But it was about sort of saying, okay, how can we reduce emissions? Then we had the first implementation plan, which was actually how do we go from having this vision of becoming carbon neutral to actually doing it. And the second implementation plan was approved last year. So it's a roadmap for 2017 to 2020. So we are taking these things one step at a time. If you look at sort of what is the roadmap and what are the four pillars that we're working on, it's energy consumption, it's energy production, green mobility, and city administration. And if you look at the percentages of how this will actually have an impact, you can see that energy production is by far the biggest contributor to getting towards carbon neutrality, whereas energy consumption and mobility and what the city does as an administration are relatively small numbers compared to the energy production. And I mean, we had a good starting point. And here is a graph that shows you that if you're working on the sort of the baseline and do nothing, this is where we would be in 2025. And this is actually where we have sort of the roadmap for 2025. That's a blue, the bottom line there. So that it shows you that we can go below below carbon neutrality in 2025. And the next step for us is also then to start looking at consumption-based emissions, because of course that's not part of this first step. This is the first in a long road toward sustainability. Mobility, that's sort of one of the things. Whenever people talk about Copenhagen, they talk a lot about our mobility, especially a lot of about the people who are bicycling. It is actually now that about 50% of trips to work and school in Copenhagen, that's a goal that we want to achieve by 2025. Currently, we are at 40%. And if you look at people who are living in Copenhagen, it's more than 60% of people who use their bike every day to go to work and school. Can you imagine having that here in Mexico City? I think it would do a lot about your congestion problems. We are actually now having congestion problems on the bicycle lanes in Copenhagen, which is something which is quite new for us also. But there's also a goal of having light vehicles run on new fuels and on heavy vehicles like trucks and buses and so on. So it's not just about getting people to bicycle, it's also about changing the mobility patterns in Copenhagen and also the fuels used for that. For energy consumption, it's very much about reducing energy consumption when it comes to heat, 20%, and a lot of that can just be achieved by being more efficient in the way you manage the system. We have a very good starting point also in general for in Copenhagen, because 99% of all Copenhageners are connected to our district heating system in Copenhagen. I think that's also a world record. So a lot can be done also by having systems that are much more efficient. Then we want to reduce electricity consumption in commercials, companies and so on, and that's by 20% and 10% reduction of electricity in households. When it comes to energy production, we want that to be completely carbon neutral by 2025. And one of the reasons that's also possible is because we have this central system in Copenhagen with the power plants that are owned by the municipalities in and around Copenhagen. So we have the direct impact on how they are actually producing their energy. And here, again, we are moving away from having a lot of the energy coming from coal to actually moving towards either biomass or even better wind. And in the future, we are also looking towards geothermal energy and so on. But at the moment, it's at sort of a stage, an experimental stage, where we cannot rely on that. A big issue for us is actually to reduce the amount of plastic from that comes from household, because in Copenhagen we have also for many years been incinerating our waste, and that is also being fed into the energy production system. It actually amounts to about 30% of the energy production in Copenhagen from incinerating waste. But we actually want to reduce that amount in order for us to make sure that we can reuse, recycle more of the materials, getting the plastic out, using the organic waste for creating biogas and so on. Last year, we introduced recycling of organic waste in household. It was sort of like a voluntary supply, or it was voluntary. And then basically, we expected that about 30% of household would start sorting their organic waste. And it actually now turns out that it's more than 75% of the households that are doing it. So it, even without enforcing it, there's actually a lot of goodwill in the city for citizens to do something about this. City administration initiatives, I mean, the main goal is here to be a front runner and say, okay, we're going to do some of the experiments, to take some of the learning lessons, and then perhaps be able to show other stakeholders in the city how we can do that. We want to reduce energy consumptions by 40%, not by 20%, as we say when it comes to other households. We have new energy codes for new buildings that we are erecting in the municipalities. We are only buying electrical, hydrogen or biofuel cars in the city wherever it's possible. We still have a problem with some of the heavy duty vehicles that are not at the moment produced so that they can run on some of these fuels. But we are currently in a collaboration with Oslo in Norway and Stockholm in Sweden. We're actually trying to say, how can we build up a demand so that producers of these heavy vehicles can actually start supplying them. One example also is we're looking very much also at cost-efficient ways of doing things. And renewing street lights in the city is one of these things. Going from normal lamps to LED light is actually deliver 50% energy savings, and it's basically maintenance free for the next 25 years. And it has, I think, the short payback time was around 5 to 7 years. The investment had actually been earned back for the city. But one thing is what happens here and now in the future about mitigation. What we are also seeing in Copenhagen is that the climate is changing, and even though we still have these very high ambitious goals on that, we still also want to work on adaptation, or we need to work on adaptation. We can see, I could have a lot of graphs about how climate scenarios, but basically we can boil it down to three words. It's going to be warmer, it's going to be wetter, and it's going to be wilder. We're going to have warmer weather. We've just come out of the warmest May ever recorded in Denmark. It's not been wet, it's actually been very dry, but in general we are seeing an increase in precipitation both in the winter and in the summer. And in the summer it also comes with a little bit wilder, having these very heavy thunderstorms, and we also are expecting more thunder, more storms in the winter. And also in eventually we are going to see storm surges with rising sea level that will have an impact on the city. So we started back in 2008 working on our climate adaptation plan, and the first sort of analysis showed us that the most direct risk for us right here now would be rain, but in about a couple of decades the rising sea levels might actually also have an impact on the city. Then this happened. This is a picture taken in Copenhagen on July 2nd, 2011. Where the city was hit by a massive cloudburst, a thunderstorm, where we had 150 millimeters of rain in 2 hours. It cost about a little over $1 billion in insurance claims in a city with 600,000 people. You can imagine that that's quite heavy. But what was more important for us was that it showed actually that the city was vulnerable. A lot of critical infrastructure were damaged. We nearly had to evacuate two of the main hospitals. The 911 call, the servers for that were placed in the basement under the main police station in Copenhagen. They're not placed there anymore, I can say. They're somewhere high up so that they will not be affected. So in many ways, it was a game changer for the city, and it led sort of to a political demand to say we have to develop a cloudburst management plan that we can manage situation like this. And one of the things that our initial work had shown us was that building out the existing sewer system in order to manage enormous amounts of rain would not be an option. It would be extremely disruptive for urban life, and it would also be a monofunctional solution and an extremely expensive solution, and also an inflexible solution, because once you've dug down a pipe, it has that diameter, and if you find out 20 years later it should have had twice the size, well, dig it up again and replace it with another one. So what we had to do was to look at another way, and this is sort of the first map of how we started. This is a model of how a big thunderstorm will impact the city, how the water will flow if you actually let it flow on the surface following the natural topography. And it looks like sort of a net of streams and rivers And this was used as a basis for our work, saying, can we actually create a natural system where we are using the surface to transport and manage the water in a way where it will have the least impact, or least negative impact on the citizens. And based on that first map, we then divided the city into seven water catchment areas. And for each of those, we did a very, very detailed plan on how can we actually manage a 100-year storm in that specific neighborhood, following sort of the natural flow of the water, saying, using a new typology that we had also developed in this, saying, we want to store as much water upstream in retention areas. They can be in parks, they can be in parking lots, on other places where you can actually have depressions where you can store some water. We can delay the water actually coming downhill using traffic measures or greening the streets to make the water run slower. We can convey the water at the lowest level with on streets where we change the street profile so that you can actually use them as small rivers for a short period of time. And finally, when you get to the very end, there are so many barriers getting out into the sea that we will have to use tunnels for the very last bit, because I'm not sure the Danish railways would be happy if I told them that we're going to build a river across some of their tracks. And a very important part of all of this, and that also goes hand in hand with our vision of being a livable city, was the fact of looking for the co-benefits of adaptation. How much can we actually create so that this is not just a question of spending an awful lot of money on something that is about solving a problem, but also perhaps creating a city that is nice to live in when it's not raining. And this is about having recreational value, biodiversity, meeting places, health issues, and so on. All these things, we said, okay, how much can we actually create out of this? And it was a task of, in these master plans for the different catchment areas, to demonstrate how we could get the most out of this situation. And this is an example. This is a lake in the middle of Copenhagen, which is relatively deep. And the suggestion is that it's if we lower the level of the water in the lake, we have the possibility to create new park areas along the wider banks on the lake. And these can then be flooded because we can use the lake as a huge reservoir when there's a lot of water. And it will prevent the flooding of an area downtown, which has had huge problems with flooding. So it's a win-win situation. It's a much cheaper way of managing a lot of water in a critical situation. But it's also a possibility to give the Copenhageners a new green area where they can have activity when it's not raining. And I'm going to end up with a few slides showing some examples. This is Torsinge Square. This is the first water park that we created in an area. There was nothing there before. There was a little green triangle that people used for walking their dogs and doing what dogs normally do. But together with the citizens, we actually sort of said, okay, how can this actually become a new social meeting place for the neighborhood, and at the same time being a place where we can store a lot of water when it's raining? And this is what it looks like on a nice sunny day. There's actually a new cafe there. They have flea markets, they have Christmas markets and so on. All of a sudden, this has become a meeting place for the neighborhood. And when it's raining, it can be used for collecting a lot of water. So it's a possibility again of saying, okay, 99% of the time it will look and work as a social meeting place. And then once every 5 or 10 years, it will look like this. Another place, this is in the central part of the city. This is how it looked before. It's right next to the Royal Palace. It was a square in an area which also suffered from severe flooding. And this is how it looks like now. We've lowered the middle of the square a little bit, and it's now used to conveying the water from where you're standing in the picture and to the very end where you have the harbor. But at the same time, it's also a place for meeting. We have removed a lot of cars, we've widened the pavement, and all of a sudden, it's not just an empty space, it's actually a place where activity can go on and things can happen. We have a few projects that are in the pipeline now. This is actually now under construction. This is a park that's actually sloping very gently down towards the bottom of the picture, and the idea is to build a wall around three sides of the park, as shown on the top here. You can see the wall used for where you can sit as basically as park furniture. But when it really rains, hydraulic gates will close, and then you can store up to 25,000 cubic meters of water in the park for a maximum of 24 hours. Then it will be let out to the general system, and the park will go back to being a park again. So it's a much cheaper way of saying, how can we actually do this? And at the same time as this is being done to manage the water, the city is upgrading the park. So it's a win-win situation for the citizens. They get less flooding in their basements and stuff like that. And at the same time, they also get a nicer park when it's not raining. The soul of Nørrebro is a final example, which is in an area with a huge ethnic diversity and a lot of sort of normally sometimes social tension. It's not that we have gang wars like you can experience here in Mexico, but we also, there are some issues with gangs in this area. So there was a long process in the development. How can we do something in this neighborhood that can both work socially and that can work also when it's raining? And this is a park in the area which is not being used a lot now, which can be transformed into this more lush, nature-like area, which can then, sometimes when it's really raining, be flooded for a short period of time. The streets can also have new green linings where it's possible for the water to run and then be just nice and green when it's not raining. Sorry. So what do we have here? We have one citywide cloudburst management plan. I think we're actually the first city in the world that has created one like that. Consists of 300 projects. It's going to cost us $1.5 billion to implement over the next 20 years. But given the fact that we had estimated that without this we would have around 3 billion of damages, $3 billion of damages, then it's actually a good investment. We've done a lot of economic calculations and so on in this process. So there's ample opportunity to come to Copenhagen in a couple of years and see a lot of these projects that are actually going in the ground and how it will also transform the city. It is one of the biggest construction projects that the city has undertaken since they actually created the sewers back in 1860-something. There are, of course, challenges in all of this. These goes for both the adaptation and the mitigation strategies. Because you're working on a long-term thing, you need to work on having a constant political and organizational backup for what you're doing. We constantly have to use or to be concerned about the economy. We have to make sure that we are choosing the cheapest solutions and we have to make sure, especially when we're talking about adaptation, but to some extent also mitigation, that it's not hindering economic development. That's something that our finance administration is very concerned about. When it's about adaptation, it's also about fitting into the existing urban life. Copenhagen is growing. We are becoming 20% more over the next 10 to 15 years. So there are lots of pressure on urban space in the city. How do we actually fit in? How do we make sure that our projects can fit in with all the other demands that there are? And finally, I must say that working in a city administration, and this is especially true when it comes to the adaptation, is that there are lots of different planning logics in city administration. And when you all of a sudden start working with adaptation, you meet up with the strangest problems, because you have the utility companies, sewer engineers, they're used to working underground. All of a sudden they have now to work above ground together with landscape architects and urban planners with a completely different logic about sort of poetry and curves and all of that. And the engineers, it's really difficult for them to communicate. And then you have the environmentalists who are concerned about the biodiversity, the life quality of tadpoles and butterflies. And you have the economists who tell us that it's going to be too expensive, and the lawyers telling us it's probably not legal anyway. So it takes a lot of meetings for these actually to meet and get together and find solution. It will come. I mean, we have been through the same process with bicycles in Copenhagen, but it's just saying that also getting the understanding of working with these new climate paradigms in the city planning is a challenge also for the way that cities work, and it's very important that you do not expect that everything will be a success from day one. And this is just a timeline to show you how we went from having the adaptation plan approved by the City Council in 2011 to actually having the final political decision for implementation of the Cloudburst Management Plan in 2015, which is for Copenhagen at least a very, very short period of time. And I think we have been greatly helped by the fact that we've had not one, but several of these heavy rainfalls that has helped us get the political attention also in this. And here I have been focusing only on rain, but of course we are also working on other issues, especially rising sea levels and so on. But I thought that would be too much to take into my presentation. Thank you.